This is not a
So our next speaker, I'm sorry, may I have your attention, please? May I have your attention? So thank you. Our next paper is paper by Joël Alouche Benayoun, who did not attend our workshop for personal reasons, not for political reasons. And she asked Samir to have you read her paper, which is in French. So just to give you a brief information about the content of this paper, it's an overview of life stories that Joël Alouche Benayoun collected for over 20 years among Jews of Algeria, born between 1905 and 1930, men and women from all strata of society. And in their memoirs, the years between 1939 and 1945 have a prominent place. So as she asked us to read her paper and to collect some questions. So, and we start to read the paper, and I won't read all of her paper, but at least the main part. But still, if you do have some questions, if you would collect them. Samir, for whatever reason, didn't show up himself, so, okay. I take his part and I start to read. Mémoire et représentation de la Seconde Guerre mondiale dans les récits de Juifs et Juives d'Algérie. Dans les récits de vie que j'ai recueillis pendant plus de 20 ans auprès du Juif et Juive d'Algérie, né entre 1905 et 1930 ou plus tard, originaire de toutes les régions d'Algérie, hommes et femmes, appartenant à des couches sociales différentes, commerçants, salariés du commerce, instituteurs, petits fonctionnaires, médecins, sages-femmes, avocats, et qui étaient adolescents ou jeunes adultes en 1939, la mémoire de ce qui s'est passé entre 1939 et 1945 occupe une place prépondérante. Situé en français en 1939, mais indigène le lendemain, en 1940, le traumatisme de cette perte de citoyenneté imprègne tous les récits. L'analyse de ces souvenirs s'organise autour de deux pôles dominants que nous allons systématiquement présenter. L'abrogation du décret Grenier et ses effets sur la vie quotidienne et l'extermination des Juifs d'Europe. Quelques précisions d'abord. On ne peut pas, si l'on veut être rigoureux et comprendre les enjeux liés à cette histoire, étudier en bloc les trois judaïcités maghrébines. La particularité irréductible des Juifs d'Algérie, c'est qu'ils sont citoyens français, avec tous les droits, devoirs et privilèges attachés à ce statut depuis 1870. Leur mutation de dhimmi, individu toléré dans la société, en citoyen, c'est-à-dire en homme libre, qui comme tout citoyen français, enfant suit l'école publique et laïque, et adulte, vote et porte les armes pour les hommes, s'est faite sur place. Lorsqu'il débarque en France en 1962, c'est en tant que citoyen français, pas en tant que juif d'Algérien, nationalité qui naît avec l'indépendance d'Algérie. Leurs co-religionnaires de Tunisie et du Maroc n'ont pas la même expérience de citoyenneté. Eux ont un passeport marocain ou tunisien, et soit, quand ils le souhaitent, demandent leur naturalisation en arrivant en France, soit l'on demande individuellement dans leur pays d'origine. Ils sont de culture française, ils ne sont pas citoyens français en naissant. Que savait-on dans les années précédant la guerre en Algérie de ce qui s'est passé en Europe et en France? Probablement, du fait de leur histoire si particulière, les Juifs d'Algérie manifestaient un goût certain pour la vie politique. Et plusieurs de ceux et celles que j'ai rencontrés me disent à quel point les inquiétaient alors et inquiètent leur famille. Les déclarations de Hitler, la nuit de Cristal et autres exactions qu'ils savaient alors commises contre les Juifs en Allemagne. Cette sensibilité et cette inquiétude étaient-elles la conséquence de leur propre expérience d'un environnement anti-juif et de leur lutte contre ceux que tous appellent les anti-juifs? Le fait est qu'ils suivaient l'actualité à la radio et dans la presse et s'inquiétaient de la montée du nazisme. Tous nous disent qu'ils savaient d'expérience ce qui était la haine des Juifs sur le plan politique et ses effets, et que pour cela, dès l'arrivée de Hitler au pouvoir, ils avaient, eux, peur pour les Juifs d'Allemagne. Certains nous racontent qu'ils avaient suivi des meetings de soutien et de participer à des collectes en leur faveur. Certains ont de la famille en France, à Marseille ou à Paris principalement, et mesurent par ce carnage la montée des dangers, non seulement pour les Juifs, mais pour l'ensemble de la société. Le 7 octobre 1940 est abrogé le décret Cromier qui, en 1870, avait accordé collectivement la citoyenneté française aux Juifs d'Algérie. L'abrogation, vieille revendication des anti-Juifs d'Algérie, entraîne la déchéance des droits politiques des Juifs et les ramène à leur statut honte, celui d'indigène. De facto, l'abrogation entraîne pour eux l'interdiction d'accéder à la fonction publique, aux mandats électifs, à l'administration. Les fonctionnaires juifs sont renvoyés. Ils seront bientôt suivis des médecins, pharmaciens, sages-femmes, avocats. La majorité des lycéens, collégiens, écoliers sont renvoyés des établissements scolaires. 2 à 7% restent toutefois admis dans les établissements dans le cadre d'un numerus clausus. Tous ceux et celles que nous avons interrogés par garde de la période de Vichy et de Pétain, un souvenir cuisant et fort pénible. Et tous racontent les humiliations, les queues séparées pour les alimentations, le renvoi de la fonction publique, le renvoi des enfants des écoles, l'impossibilité d'exercer des médecins avocats. Ce qui domine dans ces récits à ce moment-là, c'est un sentiment de très forte solitude, d'exclusion. Les anti-juifs étaient heureux de nous voir abaissés, nous disent plusieurs interviewés. Les colons, nous dit un médecin algérois, ce sont tous des antisémites. Au moment du Vichy, ils ont tous adhéré avec enthousiasme au mouvement de la Francisque. Le 5 août 1934 est un programme s'est déroulé à Constantine et si c'est les massacreurs étaient musulmans, les autorités françaises locales n'avaient rien mis en place pour défendre la population juive. Et l'absence de compassion envers les victimes au moment de leur enterrement et dans les jours qui suivent le massacre culmina dans les explications officielles qui firent les victimes et les coupables de ce qui leur était arrivé. L'alliance objective de deux composantes de la population arabe et française contre la troisième ne fait aucun doute dans les récits recueillis et les dit que les Juifs sont seuls, ils ne peuvent faire confiance à personne et très présente. En même temps que le sentiment de solitude, la fleur dans tous les récits, la fierté d'avoir tenu, d'avoir su agir collectivement à tous les niveaux. Leur seul réconfort, disent-elles, quelle que soit leur ville d'origine, fut la réaction de la communauté, soudée dans le malheur. Il y a eu à cette époque, encore plus qu'avant la guerre, des vestiaires pour les plus pauvres, des distributions de nourriture. Il y a eu plein de dames qui s'occupaient des nécessiteux. Et par-dessus tout, la prise en charge de la scolarité des enfants juifs renvoyés du jour au lendemain des écoles apparaît comme la plus belle manifestation non seulement de cette solidarité, mais aussi de la preuve de la maturité des Juifs d'Algérie. Plusieurs nous racontent la même prise en charge d'où qu'ils viennent d'un bout à l'autre du territoire. Tous nos interviewés, rappelons-nous, nous ont parlé de cette période avec douleur, profondément humiliés par ce qui leur est alors arrivé. juif d'Algérie, le philosophe Jacques Derrida, exprime lui aussi ce qu'il nomme un trouble d'identité dans le monolinguisme de l'autre. Il évoque une citoyenneté qu'on lui a donnée sans le consulter, qu'on lui a retirée sous le régime de Vichy sans le consulter, puis qu'on lui a de nouveau attribuée toujours sans le consulter. Une citoyenneté précaire, récente, menacée. Cas unique dans l'histoire, il fait partie d'une masse groupant de centaines de milliers de personnes qu'un jour on prive de leur citoyenneté sans qu'ils aient la possibilité d'en retrouver une autre, aucune autre. Sans pour autant calmer les anti-juifs, c'est pendant la guerre, alors que les juifs ont été déchus collectivement de la nationalité française, que la parole des anti-juifs s'est libérée encore plus que d'habitude. Sensibilisés à ce qui s'est passé en Allemagne dès les années 30, les Juifs d'Algérie, on l'a vu, étant inquiétés de ce qu'ils apprenaient de la persécution des Juifs. Mais personne chez eux, comme dans l'ensemble de la population, ne se doutait de l'ampleur des massacres. Quelles étaient les motivations qui ont conduit ces familles à Marseille? Que reste-t-il d'eux et de leur trajectoire dans la mémoire des témoins de ce rafle, dans celle de ceux des membres de leur famille qui n'ont pas été raflés? Zari nous raconte que son fils Claude naquit le 31 octobre 1942. Pour des raisons de santé, la circoncision n'avait été programmée le 25 février 1943. En prévision de la fête, l'appartement avait été rénové. En Algérie, les Juifs ont échappé à la déportation grâce au débarquement des Alliés en novembre 1942. Mais les lois de Vichy les ont profondément marqués et meurtris. Et lorsque la guerre s'achève en mai 1945, les familles comptent leurs morts au combat. D'autres attendent le retour de prisonniers de guerre, le retour des déportés, certains plusieurs mois après la fin de la guerre. Durement discriminé et humilié dès 1940, Vichy avait engagé des opérations de recensement à leur encontre à partir de 1941. Ils n'eurent pas le temps d'être déportés comme les Juifs de France. Le débarquement des troupes anglo-américaines a y contrarié les projets de déportation.
The idea of poverty and the awareness of the poverty of Jews in North Africa came up in your paper, and how the Vichy period made all the Jewish organizations and some of the class that Yaron just talked about as agents. But Jews in Algeria were poor even before, and in Morocco for sure. There were petitions in the 30s of Jews in the Melah Hafez, and so just something to think about what the idea of the poverty of North African Jews and how Vichy contributed to the awareness of this kind of life or the lower classes within North African Jewry. And the second thing that I don't know, maybe one of you, maybe Chaim can tell us more, is what do we know about the knowledge that North African Jews had about what is happening in Europe? There's a lot of hints all over, but if, I don't know if someone can give a larger picture of, because in all the memory, the mention that we are aware of what is happening in Europe, but there is no, I'm not aware of a word that really describe the kind of knowledge, the where they're listening. I'm sure they were listening to German propaganda before, but what kind, how did they get the knowledge about what is happening in Europe?
I don't know how you want to proceed. I guess that, you know, in the absence of Joelle, and presumably you don't want to fill in
role.
No. But if you want, I can tell you something about the Sudeten Germans.
That may be relevant. Sorry. I think, though, what I want to ask, I mean, it's not, it's a, or what I perhaps would have asked it, Joelle, but it's really, I think, a question for our group as a whole. It's more to do with methodology. And, you know, from reading the paper and then hearing, again, what the parts that you read. And the story, the narration that she recounted, I think, is there's nothing really strikingly new or unfamiliar to any of us. But it is methodologically based, you know, based on oral testament testimonies. And she said it collected over 20 years. But I'm, you know, I'm kind of wondering where the introspection of using, you know, how do you treat the you know, the remembering? You know, what's the relationship between collective memory, you know, sort of very current, long-term theoretical concept, especially among, you know, French scholars, and, you know, the act of remembering, you know, versus maybe the individuals who are doing the recounting and so forth. So I think that, you know, the fact that presumably most of these people are in France, that it might reflect somehow on how they're remembering that period. So it's kind of a methodological question. I mean, I think we all, many of us, you know, we try to combine sort of using testimonies with the documents of the time and so forth. So, and it certainly relates very much to what we just heard from Sophie, so I think we could maybe that's something.
We can give her all my questions.
Yeah, I'm wondering, especially in the case of the Algerian Jews, how the post-war experience of the revolution affected their recounting of their wartime experiences, too. This is a fact that's particular to Algeria was the violence of the revolution. Just wondering the conditions under which they left Algeria and how that might have played into their recollection of the war. But I agree with Daniel, the politics of our memory are really key here. And we don't really know the conditions under which these telomeres were collected, or how long, considerably later, many years later, it seems. So I think we need to take all of that into consideration. I wanted to respond to Orit as well. You know, it really wasn't known, even in the West, until late in 1944, the extent of the tragedy of the Holocaust. So it wasn't known, and I probably have more. It wasn't really known until late 1944, the dimensions of it.
Not really. In November 42?
Yes, there were reports.
More than reports. Yes. In 1942 it was known, but for instance, Auschwitz, the examination of Auschwitz was only known May 44.
Yeah, this was my impression, but you asked him for the finer points on it, but the general understanding of the dimensions of the catastrophe. I don't know when the news reached North Africa, but I can assume it wasn't, certainly wasn't earlier.
When they mention it, it's a later projection of the memory, the previous memory. So it's possible.
I have a question that I think is also to the rest of the group, really more than just Joelle, which is, and this is one thing I'm trying to think through, how far back do we have to go when we talk about World War II? Like, how do we need to be looking in the longue durée? Do we have to, like, focus a little more inward? I mean, in the case of my work on the Algerian Jews in World War II, I have to go back much farther to be able to explain why they respond the way they do. So it's a challenge of scope.
And why? Can you
study. Why? Because they were not really part of the Second World War.
Right.
If you're going to the heart of darkness, then nearly every day, every month counts in order to tell the tale. But the more you go to the periphery, then previous periods become more important. So it's a different perspective that has to be taken into consideration.
Yeah, and it's definitely a challenge.
Yeah.
I think all of us.
So that indicates again the question of center and periphery.
Right.
Yeah. So obviously, if you're talking about Algeria and the Clermont, you have to move to the Clermont and its story and its prehistory, even in order to understand what happened in 1940.
I think that the major difference between what happens in North Africa and in Europe is the relationship between Jews and the neighborhood. It's so different from what happened in East Europe. So in order to understand what happens in this respect, we have to go down for many, many, many generations. Even before the French occupation. I don't want to elaborate now on this subject, but I think it's a major difference.
With regard to Daniel's mention of method, I think it's a book that probably many of you know, or all of you know, Joël Bazou's book about the architecture of memory, both in Hebrew and both in English and in French, and where the focus isn't only on this period of time, it's the whole process of memorizing the past, very much contextualized, what's happening. Questions arise out of situations, and a lot of the associations are provided by the interviewees themselves rather than a frame of these are questions about such and such. And it's very much a complementary kind of way of approaching
this question. Dr. Patrick Bernhardt. Patrick Bernhardt is fellow at the Center for Contemporary History in Potsdam, Germany. He covers a broad range of topics ranging from European fascism to colonialism, from war and genocide to peace movements and Cold War cultures. He's particularly interested in transnational approaches to European and global history and is currently writing a major study on population management by the members of the Second World War Axis Alliance.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. Can you all hear me? Fantastic. Thanks a lot for having me. I found the conference so far extremely exciting project. Really thought-provoking. We'll change our way of thinking about World War II. In my paper today, I would like to move a little bit eastwards. As you can see here on the map, it's kind of entering unknown territory. Just remember what Chaim told you yesterday. No, I think he made us all well aware of how little we still know about Libya. I'm also painfully aware of my own limitations. I still struggle to get hold of of Jewish sources on Libya. Yet what I can bring in is the Italian perspective. Italy, I think, is a very interesting case because just like France, country's history is not just shaped by Eastern Western vector, but also a clear south, the north vector. So that means, Italy is both. It's both. It's a fascist regime that took part in the European War, but it is also a colonial power. And this is also the idea I would like to start with. When talking about the Holocaust, we commonly think of it as an exclusively European experience. Typically, the Holocaust is understood as the mass murder of European Jews by Germany and its accomplices on the European continent, and foremost in Central and Eastern Europe. instances of anti-Semitic persecution that occurred at the same time in other parts of the world, especially in Axis-occupied North Africa, are often not understood as part of the story. Rather, the expropriation, we heard about that today, internment and also murder of indigenous Jews by Nazi Germany and fascist Italy and Libya and Tunisia are usually framed, when they are acknowledged at all, within the context of European imperialism. And that's something I experienced when talking about that, of my project. From this perspective, crimes were committed against natives and not against Jews as such. I think you could already hear that I would like to challenge this assumption a little bit. I argue that we cannot make such a clear distinction between colonialism, which is bound to Africa or Asia, and fascism, which is bound to Europe. Rather, the lines between colonial and anti-Semitic violence were quite blurry. Particularly in Libya and Tunisia, we see various entanglements and crossovers between colonialism and fascism that defy clear geographical classification. On the one hand, colonialism was, this is maybe a little bit provocative, a major driver of anti-Semitic policies in North Africa during World War II. This helps to explain why the situation in Libya differed from that witnessed in other states under the control of Italian fascist regime, including Slovenia, Greece, and parts of Croatia. Indeed, in Libya, the fascist regime pursued a very energetic policy of persecuting Jews. Brutalized by 2 decades of harsh colonial rule and accustomed to exercising mass violence against indigenous people who dared to challenge the fascist state, the Italian regime did not need much coaxing to apply to Libyan Jews virtually the same repressive measures that were applied to Arabs and Berbers in the 1920s and early 1930s. So this is, I'm picking here up what we have just discussed. No, this is about when to start with the story. What rendered the persecution of the North African Jews so easy for Mussolini's state was, in all likelihood, the fact that many of them were of color, or were seen to be of color, unlike Italian and Croatian Jews. Yet at the same time, and this is crucial, the fascist regime still drew distinction between Libyan Jews and other indigenous people. Jews were seen as a distinct category of enemy. Indeed, beginning in the early 1940s, the regime built separate concentration camps exclusively designed for Jews. On the other hand, European experiences of anti-Semitic persecution influenced and informed the action taken by Italian and German authorities in Italy's North African Empire. Indeed, we find that in Africa, authorities borrowed anti-Semitic practices that had been developed in Nazi-occupied Europe. In Tunisia, and we already heard about that, Germans and Italians, I would add, installed so-called Jewish councils charged, just like in Poland, with organizing forced labor of Jewish men. There's thus a tangible nexus between Eastern Europe and Africa. My argument has 2 parts. First, I will talk about Italian colonial rule between 1922, when the new fascist regime in Rome reconquered, as it was said, Italy's overseas possessions in North Africa in the late 1930s, shortly before it entered World War II as Hitler's main ally. I think this helps us to understand the continuities, but also the transformations in Italian colonial rule during the war. And in the second step, I will briefly discuss anti-Jewish persecution and how it related to the famous desert war during World War II. I would argue that there is indeed an interplay between the fighting on the front line and anti-Jewish measures taken in the rear areas. Yeah, this is not disconnected, but entangled. As I said, the dynamics of anti-Semitic action in Libya and Tunisia can only fully be understood against the backdrop of colonialism. A colonial experience that was even measured against the colonial rule of other European powers quite violent. From 1922 to 1931, fascist Italy waged a very brutal colonial war in North Africa against Arab and Berber tribes that dare to challenge its imperial ambitions. As Nicola Labanca and others have shown, Italian armed forces used military terror to crush resistance. They bombed villages, used poison gas against civilians, and built several concentration camps in the desert. During these years, at least 100,000 people, or more than 10% of Libya's estimated 800,000 inhabitants, died of hunger or ill treatment or burnout outright. Thus, Italy embarked on what has been called a policy of genocide. This means there were massive tensions within Libya when the fascist regime invaded Egypt in September 1940 and North Africa became, at least to British and Italians, a major theater of World War II. During the Desert War, these conflicts simply exploded. Not only do we see, again, massive violence against Arabs and Berbers fighting for the liberation of their country, as well as war crimes directed mostly against non-white allied soldiers. And what is more, we also see anti-Semitic violence. There were pogroms and lootings committed by individuals on their own initiative, and there was also a more systematic policy of persecution by Italian and German authorities. This form of cold violence, as I would like to call it, appears to have been motivated by strong racist and anti-Semitic sentiments. The fact that many Jews had collaborated with the liberating British forces was widely perceived in fascist Italy as proof of the existence of an international plutocratic conspiracy between Jewry and the Western allies. And in the paper, I outlined that a little bit more. These sentiments, these anti-Semitic sentiments, led Italian authorities to pursue increasingly repressive policies against the Jews in North Africa. In order to prevent Jewish property speculation, the Italian Governor General of Libya issued a decree prohibiting the transfer of land between Libyan Jews and citizens of the Aryan race, as it was called. Moreover, and this is what interests us now, particular, all Jews were to be expelled or interned. More than 2,500 Jews of French and British nationality were indeed deported to Niger or to mainland Italy, and the 30,000 Jews who were Italian subjects were to be incarcerated in Libya itself. This is clearly shown by an order given by Mussolini himself in February 1942. As his chief in command in North Africa explained, on orders from the highest level, I have arranged for the evacuation of all Jews living in the Cyrenaica to a concentration camp situated in the Tripolitanian rear areas. In the second step, the position of the Tripolitanian Jews themselves shall be reconsidered as well. The above-mentioned interned Jews may also be deported to Italy. Shortly after these plans were at least partially put into action. While the Italian authorities were not able to intern all Jews living in Libya because, and this is the story you all know, because of the rapidly worsening military situation, I'm talking about the defeat of the Axis forces at El Alamein in the fall of 1942, they did manage to deport the Jews of eastern Cyrenaica. Now this is the eastern part of Libya. During these police raids, entire families were arrested, loaded onto trucks, and driven to internment camps set up by the military in remote locations in the western desert, more than 1,000 miles away. And as you can imagine, on the long journey, many died from heat-related exhaustion and dehydration. And that's something we know from testimonies. The worst of these campi di concentramento was situated in Jado. This is a very small town, 150 miles south of Tripoli. Opened up in February 1942, the camp was inhabited by about 3,000 prisoners, 600 of whom died due to exposure, malnourishment, or disease. And I think what we here see is, of course, this is not systematic killing depth that we all know from Eastern Europe, but I think this is a very remarkable case of malign neglect. Yeah, and indeed, this is my argument. It was in North Africa that the persecution of the Jews went furthest. In Libya and Tunisia, the local Italian authorities conducted a program of persecuting the Jews that was largely independent of the Germans, which in addition was very brutal and went beyond what took place in other Italian occupied territories. Yet at the same time, there was some sort of voluntary collaboration and exchange with German authorities here. Thus, Italian authorities informed German civil and military officers about their repressive actions taken against Arab and Jews, and in addition, Italian occupation authorities even adopted German practices of anti-Semitic repression. And I will be very brief here because Daniele has already talked about the Jewish councils and expropriation of local Jews. What is interesting is, and I think this is quite unknown, is that Italians also build up Judenwehr. So they actually borrowed, they borrowed these practices. Yeah, they made immediate use of this outside knowledge resource, not the German says outside knowledge resource, and as I said, established a Jewish council. Yeah, and this is absolutely unique to Italian fascism. Nowhere else do we see such a learning process going on. I would argue, and this is something I would very much like to highlight, I think we have to consider this to be a voluntary borrowing from the Germans. Yeah? There is no indication whatsoever that the Italians were actually forced to do so. No? This is often in historiography you see that argument made that the German exercised pressure. Here, this is not the case. Rather, new sources suggest that the Italian authorities were quite grateful for German expertise and the willingness of the Axis partner to take the lead in matters of anti-Jewish repression, and also when it comes to the so-called Aryanization. Indeed, Italian authorities also agreed upon the systematic robbery of the Jews of Tunisia. Yeah? So the story Daniel Lee has told us is further complicated by Italian presence. What we know now is that not only the German Reich was to profit from Aryanization, also local Arab, French, and Italian families who have been, who have lost their property during the Allied air raids were to be compensated with Jewish household goods. So, and can imagine this opens up some further questions about complicity, about taking initiatives from below in this process of robbery. Let me briefly conclude. I think it has become clear that anti-Semitic persecution in Libya cannot simply be subsumed as colonial violence, nor was it simply the import of a foreign European concept by the Germans. What does these finding mean for our conference? I would like to argue that the view from Africa on the Holocaust in Europe was probably less distanced and detached than we commonly assume. Not the Jews in Libya and Tunisia had become victims of anti-Semitic repression, and I would like to add, Arabs have also become victims of mass killings that from their own perspective took the form of genocide. So I think this is something future research on commemoration has to take into account. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to congratulate you concerning the paper, which I read with great interest, especially concerning three moments of, let's put it at that, of distinction, which should be taken into consideration. The one is war, which means Libya was a battleground. We are talking about the war and the violence which was executed at the front and at the rear, which is a very interesting subject, and even comparable to the European theater and, let's say, to the Einsatzgruppen period. War, undiscriminatory warfare. Second, colonial violence and the colonial structure. Especially talking about, I'm talking now a bit about the Italians, of course. Which I don't see a clear distinction, say, between, put it like that, the liberal Italian regime in the past and the fascist regime. I'm talking about, let's say, the consequences of the Battle of Adua in Abyssinia and the quelling of the Senussi uprising and, well, the Italian policy in the year of 1911, by embarking on that colonial project. We're not talking about fascism. We're talking about liberal, in quotation mark, colonialism. And how direct, well, I'm talking of, not about space now, but about time. 1911 was immediately related to 1912 and certainly to the Balkan Wars, where we have very similar phenomena concerning the execution of violence. And not concerning, let's say, colonial population, but among, let's say, well, in between Muslims and Christian, but even among Christian Orthodox, different nationalities or nations. So Italy is a very, very interesting example in order, well, to distinguish between this kind of violences that were executed by the different Italian regimes. And just having mentioned that, and it might be a much too broad picture that I'm offering here, if we would scrutinize into the First World War, and especially concerning Jewish history, we would see quite similar activities by the Tsarist military concerning the Jews at the borderlands. Very, very similar. And it even, moving on a very, very thin ice, I'll put it like that, even the very beginning of the Armenian Genocide, after the defeat of the Ottoman army at the advance to Baku. So how are we going to distinguish between different forms of violence? And here, concerning your subject, in India and the Cyrenaica especially, well, all the different layers are meshing. And that's very, very, even though in that very, very short period. And in so far, it's so challenging in order to distinguish.
Thank you. Yeah, so I also, what I can say, was a very nice speaker. It was also very well written, so that was a pleasure. And it's nice to see anybody working on Libya, so that is always to be lauded, right? The one thing you commented on, saying, that the lack of Jewish sources so far, I mean, I fully understand that that's a problem, and hopefully you will find it a great many of them.
The ability to read it,
I fully understand, but actually, I try to see the positive. There's also one positive aspect, despite the negative aspect, and that is because you don't have, a body of, 1,000 amazing diaries written in Tripoli and Benghazi at the time of the occupation. You're forced to look at the entire Italian archives. You're forced to look at much broader, to have a much broader picture, because you can't even base yourself on this small, narrow basis, and therefore your research also has a much, because it is forced by the basis of the sources, you engage with a much broader question. And I think in the talk right now, it wasn't so clear, but in the writing it's much clearer that you actually look at both Jews and Arabs, and you really intertwine it much more. And that's what I really liked about it, that it's not so clearly separated, but that it's really integrated into each other. And this idea of this specific Italian colonial violence, right, these concentration camps and this extreme brutality, and then you see what happens during the war as well. And obviously, I also think there is a direct link there. But then before we go too far into essentializing the Italian violence, right, I mean, the French weren't that different. I would argue one of the main reasons is that it happened, 100 years earlier. So by the time that, it had faded out by that time. So it wasn't like as compact as the Italians. And when the Italians come, they only have a few decades to make up for killing a lot of people that the French had already had longer time to achieve. And so I think it seems more, maybe it is still more extreme, but I think the contrast is not as big as you can sometimes want to think.
Yes, a comment and a question. One is the other side of, it appears to me that the other side of the sort of false distinction between colonialism and the anti-Semitism is how much of the Nazi program was colonialism to Europe.
Okay.
The whole attitude toward Eastern Europe was one of essentially treating Eastern Europe as if it were Africa. Not speaking of the Jewish issue specifically, but the attitude toward the Slavs as a subject people and colonizing the land and so forth. So it strikes me that to some extent this taking of the Mediterranean as this vast gap, as this interplanetary space, is wrong in both directions. The other question is much more specific. There has been and has been challenged the myth of Rommel as the good German. And I'm just curious in terms of your work, if you ran into any connections between the German military, or what were the interactions between the German military and the anti-Semitic regime in Libya because of this situation where the Germans were in charge of the war, but the Italians were still officially in charge of civilian administration?
Maybe I start in the last question. Yeah, thanks a lot for this fantastic question. So, indeed, I argue that this is not just a one-way street of learning, no? It's not, or of borrowing, that the Italians or local German authorities borrowed from the European experience, as I made clear in papers, there is a heavy borrowing of colonial experiences when it comes to the settlement policies of the Nazis in Eastern Europe. So they, Himmler and his men are very much interested in the experiences in North Africa, right, with settling white settlers. Oh, this is the story I briefly touched upon in my paper as well. We have white settlers there, a huge, massive settlement program that was supposed to resettle about 6.5 million white settlers in North Africa and Eastern Europe. And as you can imagine, this was highly attractive to the Nazi settlement experts, and they sent their men to see what the Germans can actually achieve, especially in North Africa. And they actually changed their settlement patterns in Eastern Europe. What really struck them was the idea of creating a new racial society in the Russian Empire. That's something where they wanted to learn from the Italians. Not so much in terms of colonial violence. Yeah, I think that would be overstretching.
In terms of colonizing.
Yeah, it's more about the so-called positive eugenic aspect of settlement policies. Yeah. It's not so much about colonial violence. I think here we would, kind of overstretch the argument by, arguing that the Germans were so much fascinated by colonial violence. It played a role, but I would argue it played a role for further justifying their own violent behavior. And just to give you an example, Carl Schmitt, the famous Carl Schmitt, actually justified the invasion of Czechoslovakia by the Italian example of invading Pacific. In both cases, we have very weak nations. The stronger nations have the right to invade, create empires. So they drew a very strong comparison between the African kings and Nazi agitation. But I wouldn't overemphasize that. Yeah? It's a further legitimization of violence. Yeah? Okay, and the second question concerns Rommel. Yeah, and the question how far the German military was interested in anti-Semitic persecution.
Are you
that's
connected?
Connected. It's probably not so much the German military that was interested, but I mean we have in the North African campaign we have officers of the SS that are coming, getting active, and they are interested in increasingly interested in Libya. Yeah, I mean they were even schooled by the Italians. This is a quite interesting thing to hear. German SS officers got a colonial training in Italy, and they were later on sent to North Africa. They were embedded into Italian colonial police there, served as some sort of liaison officers to the Germans. But they directly reported to Himmler and not to the German military.
Mm.
There's, you know, there are still, traces I have to follow more closely. What I found very fascinating is that the Italian chief of police in Libya in November 1942 handed over a list with the number of the Jews living in Libya to the German SS liaison officer. Yeah, so this
in
is
November 42.
Yeah, this means just a couple of months after the Wannsee Conference. No? So there seems to be, you know, kind of a German interest in, you know, at least having, getting an overview.
Yeah, I would like to know exactly the date, because it's important. It's the dates before or after the kind of November 14th.
Yeah, it's November, so it's more or less at the very same time. But the Germans are still very much interested in having, getting
the
a clue.
The American landing also, it's November.
Yeah,
it's
crucial. Yeah. So we have at least indication, that there were larger plans on the German side as far as North Africa is concerned. Does that answer your question a little bit?
Yes, definitely. Thank you.
And maybe I should come back to David and Dan. Yeah, and many thanks for your comments, for putting North African experience and people in wider historical frameworks. Kind of fascinating what they have to say about the First World War, the Balkan Wars. I'm not so sure if there's some sort of continuity between the liberal and the fascist regime in terms of violence. I mean, for sure, the liberal regime exercised also a considerable amount of violence, but I would argue that the fascist regime went even further, not that there were some transgressions. And I think the use of poison gas, for instance, makes a huge difference to the way the war was waged before. The more poison gas, it might be that. And the internment of, of thousands of Arabs and Berbers in concentration camps, that's something you don't see under the liberal regime. So I would, I clearly see a continuity, and maybe that also helped the fascists, no? That they could build on already existing experiences and dreams of empire building in Italy, But I think they slowly, left the liberation down behind them, even when it comes to colonial violence. I'm completely happy for having further argument. Not always. Always to say, I'm very sorry. Look at Jewish sources. Of course it can be of advantage, but I always try to at least complement the Italian sources that have a very specific way of looking. With other sources, German sources, a very interesting, just to give it as a different perspective, and British and American schools is not, I mean, you probably know that the British later on served as, you know, yeah, colonial successors, yeah.
So we continue with Daniel, that's probably, and Cole. Is
Yeah, actually a lot of my questions have already been asked, but I think it's really important drawing out the, you know, the importance of colonial violence. It wasn't, you know, first of all, it wasn't only, of course, the Jewish question. And I think the Libyan case, in a sense, exposes that in a way that I think is relevant for the rest of North Africa, but it might not be so apparent. The question, or the, also that I wanted to pose, and I think you also very interestingly stress, you know, the relationship between fascism and colonialism, and how that, you know, there are also, and that's just come up in some of the comments and discussion. But I'll take advantage of knowing that you've been working on Spain and for conversations as well. And what occurs to me also is you know, thinking about Jews as being both instruments and victims of fascism. So in thinking about, you know, the Libyan case, you know, I'm wondering, you know, there's sort of this ambivalence towards Italians, you know, who were quite numerous in Tunisia. And think about the period before the invasion, right?
The invasion of Tunisia?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, and so I'm thinking also comparatively in the case of Spanish colonialism in Morocco, where there's also this sort of ambivalence, you know, of fascist anti-Semitism, violence that was going on, how important Morocco was, in a sense, to Spanish fascism. It's playing out in the war in these different ways. So I'm wondering if you think, you know, there might be some kind of parallel in associating fascist violence and colonialism and Jewish question. And of course, in the Italian case, also there's a lot of, you know, as you've reflected in the and challenged, I think correctly, the historiography is, you know, the Italians somehow seem to present a particular case, but they weren't so bad, and et cetera.
Or even nice guys.
Even nice guys. So
depending where.
I'd like to start with an anecdote having to do with the violence in Libya, and then a more general question about characterizing the fascism in Libya, particularly Balbo. In books that, you know, casual books that describe the initial Italian conquest, it's often stated, I don't know whether this is true from the point of military history, that the first use of planes in warfare was in the conquest of Libya. And not only attacking people, but decimating the flocks of nomadic groups. And there's an anecdote from another book I read written by a doctor who was associated with the Doctors Without Borders and so forth. He said, this is such a terrible thing that I'm sure that after the war, the world would get together and outlaw the use of weapons from airplanes. So that's just the, if I work very hard, I'll be able to find the original book. With regard to the overall fascist approach, I think there are a lot of sort of paradoxes, and particularly around the figure of Balbo. There's a book written, a biography of Balbo, written by Claudio Segre, called Italo Balbo, A Fascist Life, I think, California, the 1980s. And I haven't read the book from beginning to end, but I was a friend with the author who also had written about the Italian colonization of Italy. Balbo was associated with Jews, some of whom were supporters of Mussolini and his beginnings in Ferrara. There's this incident that you cite of the flogging of Jews for opening their shops on the Sabbath in the mid-30s. Many people see this not as anti-Semitism per se, but as the strong fist that Balbo wanted to insist on turning Libya into a modern country. The Jews were very important in trying to develop tourism. They were silversmiths, they were the merchants and so forth. And there were people at that period who, by boat, maybe even by plane, would spend weekends in Tripoli and so forth. And if the Jews closed their shops, it would be a pretty boring weekend. And the Jews who wanted to refuse. Babel was showing them that we're moving towards a modern, open society developed. And these old laws, we don't have to pay attention to those laws. It's very far from other versions of what you might call anti-Semitism. And in fact, Balbo, later, after the 1938 race laws were passed in Italy, he in fact opposed Mussolini. He told Mussolini, go slow. If you impose these directly, it's going to ruin the economy if you take the Jewish merchants out of the picture. Something similar to what we were discussing with the Nobis and Mohammed V, but without all the subtle sort of messages or what was really behind their decision, Balbo just said, I'm delaying this. And he himself died in a plane crash in 1940, so that we don't know what his final policies may have been, but he is very, very definite at certain points in holding off anti-Semitic threat. I think that it's even true that he wasn't so enthusiastic about the racial laws to begin with. But I have to go back and do some reading before I make that statement.
Thank you, Colby. Your question?
Yes. So first of all, I really liked your paper. I really enjoyed it, but I can't use that word. Too much violence in my paper. you speak there about the difference between cold and hot violence and about different kinds of dynamics. And I was wondering, because especially due to the moving of the fronts, in what way did the Italians actually speak? So in the way they are creating some kind of a new racial order, but a new colonial order as well. And it seems to me, if we're talking more about the cold violence especially, in what way did they actually publicize this kind of a new order, which is a new colonial order and therefore should be, should be a part of a new worldview or a new view regarding Jews or the people living in Libya. So in what way was there really a publicizing in Libya itself and Tunisia maybe, and of course in Italy? And in what sense was really this violence also known outside of the Italian countries?
Thanks to Harvey's question or remarks. You're completely right. Italo Balbo has always made case, that is part of the specific Italian narrative of events in Italy. And he serves, I would argue, as some sort of the enlightened, the good fascist in this kind of story. Because the one who on the spot, try to unmake anti-Semitic laws, try to, yeah, it's a narrative of modernization. So I think this also serves, this narrative of course serves to draw attention away from the violent aspect of Italian colonial rule in North Africa. I have to, kind of, try to understand it more in terms of, necessary modernization of the country that has not anything to do with anti-Semitism. And I mean, you rightly remarked that he actually ordered violence against Jews. He had them publicly flogged. So I'm really not sure if this, narrative of modernization, for me it's so obvious that it has political implications, political purpose to kind of draw away attention from the violent character of fascism. So it's he's always referred to, this is it's really, seems like a very firm narrative in which Paolo will always appear. When you, read the Wikipedia entries, this story is always remembered. Into the Bible, being some sort of obstacle. And I think we have to look a little bit beyond Paolo. I mean, he's writing with Michael died in 1940. And during the war, anti-Semitic policies, I would say, fully developed. That's the story that is normally not told. What happened when Italy entered the war in September 1940, and the dynamics that we see between anti-Semitic policies, thinking, and the war. So the story is, only half of the story is always told. Just to make the case of, fascism in the end remained, a project, just a project of Rome, Mussolini and a small clique flyer on the spot, and no one actually cared about anti-Semitic policies and their implementation. So we have to look a little bit, see the full picture, and go until 1933. Instead, should I add something more?
I by no means am trying to define violent activities, Italian or otherwise. But I think it's worthwhile distinguishing between narratives, and I agree with you. After the war, many countries, people, for example, try to stress how they were victims of Nazism rather than like narratives is one kind of question. But and certainly Claudio was so great. His family had to get out of Europe, successfully got out of Italy. Was by no means interested in justifying Balbo, but it was drawing a complex historical picture. That's what was his purpose. And so I think these levels should be sort of kept separate.
And the second question was, I mean, your question concerns, was there, let's say, some sort of program, public program of Italians imagined the new order?
There is a difference between dynamics of what you use as hot violence, of course, which there are different reasons for that. And then cold violence, which is planned, and therefore there's a certain ideal behind it. And when this ideal is also ideological, and when it is within a colony, then it has some implications. And the implications are, and I'm assuming here, are that you want to make it into some kind, not only as some kind of a, maybe also as kind of a vengeance against the Jews participating or collaborating with the British, but also in the sense of creating, and in this sense, creating something like a new colonial order as well, as well as a racial one. And as such, if we you think about Germany, of course, it's a very different case than Germany, because Germany, the development was very long, and here we have something that is not only slow, faster, it also changes all the time. But still, this is exactly what I'm interested in, coming from, looking from the perspective of Germany. Was there an attempt to make this into also maybe in relation to the relationship between Jews and non-Jews in North Africa, or in relation to other issues that were important for the Italian Empire and such?
Okay, I mean, there was a vague long-term plan by the fascists, no? On how to develop North Africa. Yeah? And we're told, you know, that the plan or the idea was to settle about 6.5 million. This was based on the figures given by the most enthusiastic supporters of Mussolini. As I said, these plans remained quite vague. You know, it's never quite clear what happens to the indigenous people. Yeah, but I think it was, let me put it this way, it was clear that they would be removed to the fringe of the new colonial society, yeah? If they would become kind of helots to the Italians, yeah? And they were resettled, yeah? That's something you find in the paper. They were resettled. They got, you know, the land, the less fertile land, yeah? So they were really pushed to the fringes of society. And of course, there was no plan of killing them entirely. The Italians also knew that they still needed
more
labor force.
So maybe more pragmatic question.
Yeah.
Did it appear in the newspaper?
I mean, there is a vast discussion on the so-called New Italian Order, yeah, in among intellectuals, yeah, among experts in resettling. Yeah, that's something you find. Yeah, but it remains more vague than, for instance, the German plan for Eastern Europe. Yeah? They come to a certain point, yeah? A little bit more concrete. That's something, at least that's something we have not found yet. Yeah? Might be that there were, you know, more concrete plans also on the Italian side, but so far we haven't found that. So there was no Generalplan Süd, if you, this would be the question, yeah? And the second question was, you know, how far these forms of violence became known abroad, no?
Yeah.
Yeah. And they became known. Yeah. This is a very unfortunate story. Of course, you know, almost all European powers had diplomats on the ground who reported often monthly from Libya, at least, you know, before the Second World War starts. Some colleagues have already made use of this material. I did as well. Yeah, the British reports are quite consistent. They see other things, yeah, that the Italians have their blind spots. I've just seen that someone else used the French consular reports to, you know, show that violence was really commonplace in Libya even before the war started. Especially the British were very much interested. You know? I mean, they, for a more, you know, strategic reason, they tried to understand, can we prevent rebellions, yeah, in Libya in case of, go to war with Libya. So, and that's what they actually did, by the way. Yeah? They hired Arabs for intelligence. And some of these Arabs, again, excessive violence, by the way. Yeah? So here too we see kind of an interrelationship with local violence exercised against locals and the wider picture of the war. Yeah. And by the way, a deep regret by the British. Yeah, that's something. There's still Apoki. Sorry. Okay.
So, thank you very much for comment on the
Mary Shorey's son. I have the impression that there is indeed a parallel between Spanish and Italian experience. I briefly read in the account by Isabel Boa that when the Allied landed in North Africa, that there was within, let's say, the Spanish regime, also the idea of Jews betraying the nation, yeah, and collaborating with the Allies, what they actually did. So I think we see the same pattern, no, of, you know, giving proof of the existence of a world Jewish conspiracy against them. But I mean, the war in Spanish Morocco, over Morocco, took a different way, you know? I mean, there was no fighting, yeah? And unlike in Libya, yeah? And I think maybe the story would have been different also in as far as the Spanish regime is concerned. Would there have been, you know, more fighting and simply the opportunity to retaliate, yeah? Persecute Jews. So once again, the conduct of war was different.
That's a very, very quick question. Yeah. So because I was very much impressed about the fact that the British were cheered by the population when they were advancing, which is something very impressive during those days. And what I would like to ask you concerning the Germans, how were the Germans perceived in distinction to the Italians? Because if I would move more to the east, and I would take a gaze from Cairo, then I would see the split between, let's say, the one party on the one hand and the royal court on the other. Yeah, anti-Italian on the one hand and pro-British on the other hand. And does it say anything concerning the mood among Libyans, if one can talk about Libyans, concerning the, both the intrusion of the Germans, now the Germans were appearing, in the relationship and in contrast distinction to the Italians and their colonial policy?
I would like to collect three other questions. Alma, Yaron, and Schellinger.
So two little questions. One relates to some of the broader themes that others have brought up in the context of this workshop, which is the question of commemoration. And what participation is there with Libyan Jews? What's the commemoration, public consciousness, memories? Have you been aware of this big thing? And the second question concerns Italians scattered around North Africa before the Second World War. After, and I wonder if you have any insight as to their changing perceptions of themselves as North Africans, in a sense, and what their understanding is in Libya, their relationship to the Italian state, even if many of them are approach subjects by that point. What does that all
I would like to raise the question of the way one should give to the war experience of the local Jews, as manifested by themselves, by their, first of all, by speaking publicly, and by their choices, by their movements, and clearly your historiographic narrative divert from the one which we till now were encountering, which was formed probably by Lorenzo de Felice, by Daniel Carpi, by others, which described the Libyan experience as we can call it. Cold persecutions, hot persecutions, cold or mild persecutions, and the advantage of this narrative was that it corresponded with the war experience as was expressed by the Jews themselves of Libya. For instance, by the preference for Italian regime even after the war. And this is also correspondent with the Vichy, with the experience of Vichy war experience of the Jews of Morocco, Algeria, and Tunisia, as not hot persecutions, but mild ones. Okay? So the question is, what way should we, to your opinion, should we give to this particular element when we weigh the different proofs of what happened during the war?
Can you introduce your question?
Oh, yes, thank you. So I have a very specific question. You mentioned in your presentation about bombing victims, Italian bombing victims receiving Jewish property. And you may have said more about it in the paper, and I didn't get a chance to read it. But my question is, I assume you're referring to Italian bombing victims in Libya itself? Okay, and if that's the case, is it also the same situation in Italy proper? Were they also using Jewish property? Because obviously lots of bombing victims in 1943. And then finally, is this compensation of victims through Jewish property, is this something that they were learning from the National Socialists in Germany?
Ganz kurz, okay, very short answer.
This
is circling the square. Yeah, I have to be very, very brief. The perception of the Germans. Yeah, I mean, this is definitely, this question is simply too big. This would have to make a difference. Yeah, in Libya, exactly. Yeah, yeah. And I think we have to make a difference between different, ethnic groups. Yeah, it's always, yeah. Depends very much on thinking. Just one anecdote gives you some clue of that. There were instances in which Arabs asked the Germans for help against Italians. They were tired of getting robbed, and the Germans seemed to be, to them, some sort of, anchor of stability, people who were, they had a special interest, of course, in Arabs, and having good relations to Arabs, so that seemed to be, the power to, relate you. Yeah, I mean, for Jews, of course, it was a completely different experience, and how they view Germans. Bigger threat than the Italians were. Very briefly. Commemoration. I mean, I've just started, getting into this question of how all these events were remembered or not remembered after 1945. In general, I would say that there is in Italy, among Italian Jews in general, not mainland Italy, the tendency after 1945 to really integrate into the Italian society and to downplay the meaning of fascism. And that's something that scholars of Jewish origin have very self-critically asserted only recently, not. But there is some sort of tendency to forget about fascism and start the story in 1943 with the Germans occupying Italy and Italy becoming a victim. So the main narrative in England has been for long. We were first victim to the fascists and then to the Germans. And I have the impression that Italian Jews very much clung to this narrative in order to reintegrate Italian society. And I think that's something that might be of interest to see. Does that take place among Italian Jews as well? How did Italians view they're Italian us, is that a question? Yeah?
No. Italians scattered across the city,
yeah.
All of these different colonial settings, right?
Yeah.
In the way that we've done is really interesting for many reasons, but one of them is Italy as a colonial art alongside French colonial powers, and these different experiences of not just, I mean, so much of what we've been discussing is French subjects and French colonial power, but we have a multiplicity of these imperial subjects and discourses circulating, so it's just a curiosity question.
I can't tell you much about that. I'm not sure if there are some experts here that we can help, but I have the impression that this has not been studied very much. For instance, how it happens if actually fail. Fascist activities were some considerable among some of them, but I don't dare to speak of the Italian population doing it. Yeah.
There are reports of the Italian community in Alexandria being very excited to welcome Ramos' troops that were supposed to be here the day after tomorrow. But those reports are very British reports, so I'm not sure whether it's true.
Jean's question is fascinating, really. I don't know of any case of, you know, Aryanization in mainland Italy. The nexus that they made in Tunisia, between, you know, Allied bombings and Aryanization. I think that is really unique to North Africa. Further confirms my thesis that, you know, there's this very specific dynamic between the colonial context and the war. And it only happened in such a specific colonial context. On war experience. I mean, I think we still have to dig a little bit deeper and kind of historicize De Felice. I found it fascinating that this 1961 account, I guess, Jews in an Arab land was actually very much supported by the Jewish community. So there was obviously
there's a long story to that. There's one man in particular.
Okay.
Don't have time.
Sorry, we still have two questions.
I'll forego my slot. It's okay.
But you waited for.
It's all right.
Just go on.
I'd like to ask you about epiphenomenon of the Libyan. Your study of Libya, your talk is fascinating, and it's always interesting to me how people are drawn and want to talk about Libya. And there's it's a topic that has a tremendous fascination, and we know so little. But I wanted to ask you about Libyan refugees. And if you've stumbled across in your researches any information on this group of Libyan Jews who were sent out of Tripoli during the war and actually traveled across North Africa seeking refuge and finally wound up in Morocco and were taken care of there. Did you ever find anything on that? Because I was curious about who let them go and why they were sent away.
And the last question, please.
Certainly, the case of Libyan Jews is very interesting. And I'm wondering about the term you use about violence in Libya. As far as I understand the things and the policies in Libya, there was no program for extermination of Libyan Jews. Not an Italian program, at least. And this is the only case in which you can find difference between the attitude of the Italians towards Tripolitanian Jews and Sri Lankan Jews.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't happen in Morocco, Jews and Tunisia.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as I understand what's happened, the case of Benghazi Jews is unique because they were extradited to Jado,
mm-hmm.
but not the Libyan Jews, not the Tripolitanian Jews. And what's more important, that the Italians didn't took any measure yet to harm the Jews in the camp, in the Jado camp.
most of the Jews that died in the camp died from the epidemic, not more than this. So that means that there was no program that
It's a different way. Yeah.
It's a very, very different way.
Yeah.
Because Hebrew sources, don't worry about it, there is no written Hebrew source. As far as I know, most of the sources are testimonies the Jews gave just after the war, very important in 1960, but unfortunately no written sources, and if you review the Italian sources and the British sources, I think it's very important for the Indian case.
Yeah, I mean, very briefly again, thanks a lot for your comment. I mean, indeed, there was no open program of annihilation by the Italians, that's for sure. That sets the Italian case completely apart from German, at least, let's say, the German action taken in Europe, no? We heard about Tunisia, the restraints existed there for the Germans. I slightly disagree with you as far as the tribulating Jews are concerned. I think what becomes clear from Mussolini's order of February 1942 is that they abandoned the distinction between Jews who had actually collaborated with the enemy and Jews who had stayed in their eyes loyal to the regime. Yeah? All Jews in February 1942 were to be interim. I think that is a huge step forward to what the regime had done so far. Yeah, so I think that is definitely a transgression. And I would also, it is clear that Jadu was not Auschwitz. Yeah, I would never argue this way. But, there is a different form, maybe also, of killing people. Yeah? You don't have to gas them or shoot them. Yeah, maybe it's simply sufficient not to nourish them anymore. Yeah, this is a policy, and it seems that it was a deliberate policy of neglect. Yeah, I mean, the Italians after 1945 always claimed that we did not have the necessary resources to take care of, for instance, internment Jews or POWs. It becomes clear when you take a closer look that this is actually not true. They had means, I think that was a deliberate decision to neglect these people. Yeah, this is a kind of very sophisticated way of killing them. Because in the end, you can always say, it was not our fault, it was circumstances in the war. Yeah, but I think we should take that a little bit more seriously. I already said that. I'm simply not aware of Jewish refugees from Libya. Yeah, so thanks for
you can't know everything.
For
thank you very much, Patrick. Fire for questions and ready to show the
hand out vouchers for lunch. Make an appetite. Okay. זה נכון, האמת שצודקת, חשבתי לשאול